everyone, this is Sonali. Thank you all for carving out some time for attending today's webinar on the episode 11 of the BusinessX learning series, Invest, Scale and Value. Today's topic is on brand building, the defining factor of scaling up. To all the attendees out there, please type in any questions you might have in the Q&A section and we'll try to answer as many as possible at the end of the session. I would now like to welcome our speaker, Mr. Gaurav Marya, Chairman and Founder of the Franchise India Group. A very warm welcome to you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Sonali, and welcome, friends, and welcome to another edition. It's the 11th edition of BusinessX platform. BusinessX, as Sonali said, is a platform part of Franchise India Group, but focuses on a lot of investment side. So a lot of startups are even scale-up companies which are now looking to raise capital, they come to this platform and we help them to reach out to both angel funds, private equity, family offices, and so on and so forth. And also BusinessX has a big, you know, we are the largest network from business resale viewpoint. A lot of people who want to now look at exit of their businesses, they come and we value them. We have a special technology which is called bizequity.com. You all can go on a BizEquity. Where you can value your business yourself. So these are two prominent things. So the purpose of these webinars is really to talk about the companies which we really work with. We work with a lot of these, what I call small to mid-sized businesses. And small to mid-sized businesses, we are talking about three things every time. One is obviously invest. Second is scale. How do you really scale? And how do you really build value in a business? They're very integrated, from perspective. So we touch upon topics which are subject to investors, people when they're looking to invest into early stage companies, what they should look at. We also talk about companies which are now looking to grow their businesses, what are the challenges they're going to talk about it. And more importantly, I really love to work talk to a lot of fellow entrepreneurs and business owners because they don't understand value building. You know, how do we build value in the businesses? And we get a lot of companies and reaching out to us and we look at the businesses and the businesses doesn't have inherent value. And one of the areas which we would talk about next, say 25 odd minutes is brand, you know, and I will give you some perspective. One, I'll give you first perspective, which I've covered in my last edition, is really growing and versus scaling. You know, growing is a very conventional old school of growing your organization, which in terms of your better network, better distribution, better top line and things of that nature. But this is classic growing of companies where, you know, in the manner where you proportionately also grow your resources, which means that I would have to have more, you know, offices being deployed, more people being deployed. Very clearly, every dollar you get, you have additional investment to be done to get that additional dollar. But scaling up companies, you know, companies which scale up actually don't do in the same proportion. With a very small investment, you can multiply multiple times. And this is why technology companies are much more valued, because they continue to multiply. And look at companies like which are most valuable companies. They are not even creating content. People are creating content for them, like Facebook, Google, everybody is creating a content for them. Everybody has become, and they're not paid for it. Rather, they spend more on it to create content for them. So these companies will continue to go and multiply. So companies have to really see through that how you design a company, your business model, re-engineer your business model, that you can shift your mindset from being just growing to scaling. Now, another area which is for scaling companies, which I have realized lately, especially this COVID period and other things happening around, we're getting a fantastic businesses which are coming to us. These are great businesses, great structure, but they lack brand. They have no brand. You know, they're very me-too offering, and I'll give you some perspective on this. I get pretty much three types of companies which are coming to us at this moment. One, I see great product, great service, but no brand. I mean, there is a brand, but there is no recall value. People don't really consume them because they were brand. I feel that these companies are in huge danger, huge danger, because when this all is over, they might have no customer left, right? Or somebody would create equal competitive product available for them. Even if they were having a big ride, a pre-COVID scenario from their product viewpoint, that differentiation, if there is still a window, they still can go out and create some kind of a brand equity. But if there is no window for you to really have a competitive product coming in, then it will be a big danger for you. Then the second companies are essentially people who have built the brand, but maybe the business is still at this stage because of the reasons of COVID and other things is not there at the same level. I think they would rebound much faster. They would rebound much faster and they would be able to consolidate their position. provided they have other strategies of their business in mind. So brand would take care of a lot of other issues from them. Like, for example, let's talk about Oyo. Great brand, very strong work Ritesh Agarwal has done in terms of building the brand equity, very strong brand equity. But the business has struggled. Business has not struggled because of COVID, but business has struggled for last 1 year itself. But I feel that he has still a big, better position to really rebound the business when the things start getting normal. And he can extend the brand to many other things, which can be probably fit into the whole value of the brand and so on and so forth. And then there are third side of companies, which I'm seeing, which are actually building the brand in this period. These are great organizations because these companies would really, to me, would be the next big opportunities. The opportunities which are being built in these times, the brands which are built in these times are going to be there with people for a very long period. So you have to really see where you fit in, how you really fit in, and how you really want to shift that. So building a brand is very important, and building a brand which has two major factors to me. How do you really set the value, how valuable the brand is to the consumer, how valuable it is. And second is how much sustainability he carries. So these two are very important. Sometimes you create a good valuable brand, but sustainability is missing. Now these times, I think we both have to marry these two things, and then only the brands would be enticing. Like, for example, the electric car, electric business, Tesla is a great story of these two things. You know, it's a sustainable technology, sustainable ecosystem. While the business is still very small, the business is still not penetrated, and how these companies become more valuable than even Toyotas and the likes of them, which have the largest distribution available, the largest brand equity, largest consumer base, everything is there. But then look at the company's valuation of Tesla because of sustainability. Sustainability, their investment towards sustainability, their investment towards the technology, which is next 30 years, 40 years, 50 years of future technology. While their offering is still not reached everywhere, but clearly the investors are liking this story better. And this is strong answers which we are getting these days, that how do you really demonstrate a strong sustainability of your business or your brand for next 10, 15, 20 years? It can be through thriving technologies and so on and so forth. Like even Narendra Modi's statement yesterday is all about the creativity and thinking, critical thinking, and how do you really able to do this piece. So, and especially in this technology driven world, I think the challenge is that things have been now becoming very, very scattered and very fragmented. You need to have a lot of shared values which should come in. You have to build your personality of the brand, how you build entire thing. And you need to also go deeper in fulfilling the need of the customer, much deeper than earlier it used to be. So how do you really bring the shared value? How do you build the strong personality of your brand? And how do you go and fulfill your deeper need of the brand? It also, it's end of the day, it's all old school, what it stands for, what would it customer buy, why would he buy, what is the purchase decision, what is the purchase trigger, all that is important. But now in these times particularly, we need to really see that what is the shared value, what is the value, shared value which we brand really reflects, what is his personality, and what is the deeper need which we are going to fulfill with the consumer. Now, a couple of things which are... I would say that before I've been given tips on in terms of how you should really invest into your brand, and different products would have different brand strategy. But things are which are very important for one to understand what is sometimes lacking in the companies which we are getting. You know, some companies come to us which have a great product strategy, as I said, but no brand. Now, the danger I see in this business is that they have a good product which is currently compelling and has a good wave and good run. Say, for example, you were selling something on Amazon. Now you're selling everything on Amazon. You have a demand side. Like these days, people have become innovative, and somebody was selling PPE kits, which was 2 months, 3 months back. We were almost hearing everybody got into disinfection and things like that. So to me, these are all good stories because they clearly saw the wave and they wanted to ride the wave, but they have no brand. So eventually, as then when competition would trigger them, business would, product would become commoditized, they would all vanish. So a lot of these companies which come to us, which have a very me too kind of a product, maybe they got the wave right, but because they have not built the brand, they would not stay in the business. That's for sure. Even companies which have currently a monopoly as a product, you have got something which you only got and people are consuming from you, and you've still not built the brand. It's actually a shame, because if you got something like that, that's an opportunity for you to quickly build your brand. If you not build the brand, then you're waiting for somebody to match your product. And if start matching your product as it will get matched, then your relevance would become lower and it will be difficult for you to get new customers in. And so this is a very short window which people have when their product is very compelling and it's been in the demand in the market. And quickly they shift also equally focus on building the brand and staying what you value, what you believe on. So that would become a very important part. Second is a lack of alignment in your organization itself. You know, people get very clearly driven from functional roles, but they don't have a strong alignment as a company for your brand, what the brand stands for. And every single member of your company has to stand for the values of the brand. And unless and until that alignment comes in, and sometimes alignment is totally broken from a founder, it's a very different perception to people who are in the market has a very different perception. And especially when you run businesses which have, you know, a lot of, people at a different tiers of functionality, you bringing in some kind of consistency is very difficult. So if you're running a business, which is like an advertising agency, very easy to really spread the culture. It's very clearly same kind of age group of people, same kind of structure. But when you run an industrial organization, you have one way blue collared workers, one way you have people sitting with a little bit of a management backgrounds. So different kind of a class people. So how do you really integrate a brand culture? And these are Japanese companies that have done it phenomenal. If you go to Japanese factories, you will see the CEO from a worker down the line having the same kind of a culture and behavior. So they institute this. Indian companies are disconnected. They're broken. This is very clearly broken. What a large part of the organization, 80% of the organization don't do, especially in the industrial side of organizations, the culture and the brand is absolutely broken. Then another point, which is very important, is the poor and inconsistent decision making. You know, these days, especially this is happening. A lot of people are taking a lot of decisions very fast. And these decisions sometimes don't go with the brand. You know, some people have changed the product strategy. Some have done something else. But your brand says something else. You know, brand is talking very different than you trying to do something else. And that's something which I personally feel is not good. In the short term, it can really maybe benefit you from some cash flows viewpoint. But in the long term, it will have a bigger impact. So you need to have a strong and long-term decision-making rather than short-term decision-making. Unless and until there is a immediate opportunity or something which you want to really cap, staying within the framework of the brand, then it is fine. But I feel that particularly these times, these tiring times, a poor and inconsistent decision-making can spoil your organization. That's very, very important. Competitive vulnerability in terms of how your competition is behaving and how competition is going to do that. How is the cluster building up? How you differentiating yourself from there? That's also a very important point. As a brand, we need to really see that what we are, our set of consumer are engaged with us. We're not diluting the whole impact. We're not just going in the same clutter. Our clear landscape, which we have to define that what is our landscape, what is the competition doing, but not just try to do or repeat what competition doing. Find your own place, find your own structure. That's very important. And lastly, which also we are seeing these days is a lot of desperate communication offerings. People are discounting too much in the market, or they would running some offers which to me sometimes it doesn't make a financial sense. And this has happened in one of the industries which we closely work with. And I was saying this for last 2.5 years that they're killing themselves on the field. So the food business, particularly food business, in last 2 years, almost everybody started losing money. Why they started losing money? Because of this. The over discounted went into the market. Everybody was trying to do this 1+1 free and things of that nature. And it started with some of the invested companies. You know, I would say the companies like Fasos and likes of them, while they have used the investor money big time, and even Burger King and even other companies, they have used a lot of investor money. They have burned a lot of investor money. I have no shame to do that. A huge amount of money has been burned, but they also killed a lot of other players in the market. Because I don't see any sense of Burger King, anybody in Burger King can give me any form of advice and say how they would sell a 45 rupees or a 50 rupees 1+1 burger free, 1+1 burger and as an offer in a 50 rupees. Now this is being extremely desperate, and they are doing it not in this COVID time. They were doing it before that. I don't know who are they going to place that, what kind of revenue they were trying to drive, who are they trying to handle the competition, but eventually they would have burned their own balance sheet. The entire balance sheet would have burned. But when companies like this, of this stature, do something like that, they actually kill a lot of other people in the market. Not that they would do benefit to themselves, you know, because they've spoiled the whole mindset of a customer itself, because customers start expecting a 50 rupee one burger plus one burger coming to them. That's, to me, is a ridiculous idea. And these were done by a lot of companies who wanted to unridiculously scale themselves. In their scaling, they not only damage themselves, but they damage the entire industry. To me, it would take a lot of long time where people start realizing that the good quality product or good one bad thing would have to be paid them. Nobody was expecting Burger King to do that, but they did it. And we saw 20, 25 years of McDonald's surviving in the market, and they never did this kind of deals. They never came up in these kind of, they did one or two times in the past when they launched their veg burger, they wanted to really put this entire thing. They did some trials and they pushed the price back to the normal because it was very difficult to take it back. Same thing in one time Domino's did when they brought the 50 rupee pizza and they had to very big difficulty to bring the price back. And I think maybe the same learnings didn't come to companies of that nature, and they started disturbing their own brand itself. So these are five mistakes which you can do. One, don't just put your all energy on the product side. Parallelly build your brand. Second, get your alignment with the organization. Third, don't take poor and inconsistent decision making. Fourth, understand your competition. See how vulnerable that situation is. Fourth, don't take desperate communications and offerings out. You actually create a lot of disrespect for your own brand if you do a lot of desperate offerings and so on and so forth. So you need to really work, in terms of what I call the intentional way of designing the brand. You have to be very intentional about that. It should be expressed with a lot of consistency. You need to be also really see that there are two things which should match, your personality of the brand and the values you really bring. You need to blend these two things. How do you really blend the personality, and how do you really, impart values which the brand stands for? If you are able to do that, then I think there is a greater opportunity for you to build the brand. Now, let's go into even more deeper in terms of what is happening at this stage from a changing consumer priorities. Consumer is certainly, when it started, a lot of people were asking me that what would happen. So my opinion was different. I'm honest about it because I used to say that nothing is going to change in 2 to 3 months. It's just a pause, and no behavioral changes would come. We will start coming back to things as a, what I call normal. And now, because when it's all dragged a little too much, it's now gone to about 6 months, and we don't know if it is ending in the next 3 to 4 months. I think some permanent changes would come in the consumer side. A lot of permanent changes would start coming in. So obviously usage of technology is one set of estimate, but a lot of other changes and some changes were already there, but it's become even more stronger now. Like, for example, opinions. Earlier, we used to buy things by our own choices or while, people you know around and things of that nature. But now you're taking opinions with people you don't know. So a lot of opinions are set in the market. Very fast opinions are set in the market, and very fast people react on that. So it's very, very, in that sense, I feel that this is not the greatest time for organizations, because they don't get even a breather time. You suddenly, somebody can damage your brand in a big, big way just because the whole opinion making is becoming a way of life. People are just making opinions. Look at what is happening around us in this media space and things like that. A lot of people who don't know the subject or understand the subject, but they would make opinion on it. So this is now a way of life. People make opinions very, very fast. And that's something which is just a way of life for you. And how do you really, one, build your brand on that? You can build a brand also. This is a very unique situation where people are building brands on setting these opinions in their favor, right? And sometimes you can destroy the brand because sometimes you're not able to manage that. This is very, very difficult situation, especially for established brands, because established brands become more vulnerable. They're more vulnerable, they more have ability to people to pull down them and things like that. But for a lot of new brands, they can use this as an opportunity. They can use this as an opportunity to build their own brand equity because they can actually talk through consumers. So not talk to consumers, but talk to through consumers. That's very big value. A lot of marketing also has become very, I would say more scientific now. It's the whole brand building is now driven by tools and techniques and things of that nature versus a lot of old school, ways of building brand and so forth, which is one side good because it's very do-it-yourself kind of a market, which is becoming. And you also have to really think through that. I mean, I would say at this stage, even brand building, you should not go all over. This is one of the areas which people do mistake. They try to go all over. this is a good time. This is a great time where, you know, a lot of medias are available, a lot of other things are available, a lot of collaboration is available. But you can also do that. For example, I just advised one of my companies, so they were running a business of laundry, the laundry chain in India, largest laundry chain. And we wanted to really build even more brand at this stage, what bigger capability and things that reach out to customer, create more value for them. And so what we did is we approached to a company called FedEx. Now FedEx is the world's number one logistic and delivery company, and said, look, you setting up shops of FedEx, don't set up with us, collaborate with us, and every Uclean shop can also have FedEx. Or every Uclean can tomorrow have maybe Amazon also around that. So what it does is, it gives much bigger value to Uclean. It gives obviously distribution to FedEx, because FedEx would get into 75 odd cities. So these kind of brand alignments, I think, creates much bigger value at this moment. So at this stage, this is a time of collaboration. One has to really think through what kind of collaborations you can do with your brand. How can you really, and I think you can rub off with other brands, which in a positive sense, but what value you bring to them, what value you would be able to bring to these companies, that would create a much more significant difference in the way it is needs to be approached. So a lot of collaborative time has now come in. Now, let's look at, obviously I've talked about, there is an old school of building a brand and there is an absolutely new school of building the brands. But I'll give you some statistics. Another big statistics, which is very important, is that it significantly changed in people's mind, that people are thinking that social media particularly, or social connectivity, is now up to 91%, where people feel that it impacts and connects world. So 91%. So it's really gone to the top. You know, it cannot be bigger than that. And 64% of customers feel that they can be connected by the brand through obviously digital and so on and so forth. And 70% of consumers feel more connected to the brands with their CEOs being active on the social media. It can go wrong also. In like in MI's case, it was a classic example. He was a very popular social media, as a CEO available in the market, very big following, everything going on dieting. But when things are not right, it can backfire on you. But large part of organizations are reflected to their CEOs or founders or people being connected in the media themselves. They're available themselves. So they're pretty much are available to really launch their products, launch this entire thing. So this all is change. People are looking more people, because social is all about people. So people want to really connect with people rather than, you know, organizations talking to them. So they don't want to really see any kind of communication. They want to really hear people talking about it. So a lot of your organizational key people should come in the front. And that also is a big way of building a brand. Another thing is that you need to really find a connection through intention. You know, how do you connect with people? It has to have a strong intention. What do you really want from them? What are you looking from them? Stand for something, you know, don't just communicate, but you have to stand for something which is very important. Another area which is very important is the culture and marketing are deep rooted. They're together. You cannot separate them, right? So whatever you communicate, whatever you say to build your brand, when you start your marketing, it also has to be connected with your culture, what you really stand for. And last, which is what I call how and more approach, how versus more approach, which means it's not really about how to approach, it's about more to approach. It's not about spreading more, it's about how to approach. What is the way you really want to approach your customers, clients? What do you want to communicate? What do you want to stand for? This will all make sure that how your brand is recalled in the market. So if I have to summarize this situation for scale up, I think at this stage brand would become a very, very strong strategy. Whatever product you are in, it's very critical for you to understand that if you're just relying on the product and you're just thinking that you will only last because you had a strong value proposition on your product side, would not take you through. Somebody would become your competition soon. Somebody would match your product or take it even higher. Somebody would have even ability to give you better, price. And then you will not be able to stay in the market. So it's quickly you need to really shift focus and say, while continue to deliver my product or a service in the market, but let me also concentrate and build a sustainable and a valuable brand in the market. So valuable and being sustainable, these are two important parts of the brand. So over to you, Sonali, if you have any questions for me. We have another 2-3 minutes left.
Thank you so much, Gaurav sir, for another wonderful session and for sharing your insights. We do have a few questions lined up with us. I'll just take them one by one. So the first question is by Mr. Salik Faraz. He says, please give three key strategical recommendations for brand building in fresh fruits B2C segment.
So three strategic recommendations in fresh food B2C segment, right? I've done just now a project for B2C fresh fruit segment. Actually, I used to see in globally, there was the fruit doesn't come like what we get in India. You know, we get a full fruit, but in other countries, in Europe particularly, you get cut fruits and nicely packaged so people can directly consume. So it's a very clumsy exercise. If say you want to take fruits to an office or take to any other place or at your workplaces, which people want to do. So there are two concerns for you. One, you how do you really cut the fruit and put this in there? I think it's one time consuming, clumsy, bulky to do that. So and the cut fruit, the problem is that it just doesn't have a shelf life. So there's now technologies available which can give you a not humanly touched product. It can be still be packaged, nice boxes, not touched by a human. So it's safe, very, very safe to consume. And it also gets you shelf life of 3 days. The same thing you can do. So I feel that when you're doing a business like commodity, only thing which would change is your experiential value. You cannot make Apple cheaper than what is available in the market. Apple would be Apple. It will be same price everywhere, single that. You would obviously differentiate the little bit of quality and dieting. It's end of the commodity. It will play that in dieting. The only thing which would change is experiential. What is the last mile experience difference you would be able to create? And if you are able to make and work only on that part, rest, forget about this. This is a very good question, actually. If you just work on the last mile experiential and product can keep changing, evolving, that's okay. But if that is there done, then there is a bigger opportunity where you can do.
Right. The next question is, what kinds of brand building process should be on for companies started during the pandemic and how brand building can change after the pandemic or this economical slump?
As I said, I mean, I clearly see that three types of companies in the market. One had a offering because the market was growing. Everybody was selling. So I was also selling, but I had no brand equity. I feel that these companies are in danger. They're in danger because when everything is going, everybody can sell everything, right? So this is the nature of the entire thing. So if you are producing something like, say, I know a company in Jaipur, which makes this kurtis for women, right? And they would do about a 4 million, 5 million kind of a production because they were the, you know, put it on the marketplace and they would just start selling. So these companies, while they can be still a manufacturing company, that's fine. But when things are going good, any player like that would create a maximum value because the market is very interesting. But when market starts shrinking, consumer becomes very conscious about where they want to invest and how they want to invest. So at this stage, these companies would have big problem. These companies who were running only for economy of scale, just mass producing, just were doing the entire thing, might not be able to survive in the market. And I think the brands which would be strong, brands which would have their own good recall value, would survive better. But I also tell you, these times, new brands would be born. A lot of new brands would be born. New opportunities would come in the market. A lot of people would shift and create their brand into more relevant answers. And these are a kind of companies which we would start seeing this. And I think the first two quarters of any recession is all about taking control. But now people would start becoming, and I think you're already seeing, you know, Mahindra launching the new Thar, which is coming in. It's all over the internet, all over the entire thing. Why it is happening, Mahindra clearly saw. This is not time to really go out and create. You have people who are fans. So he wants to now encash fans. He doesn't want to go to customer because commuting is not people who are going to drive people out to buy. He's very clear. He's very sharp. He saw that commuting is not a preference today. People don't just because I want a new car, he's not going to make a purchase. They will not make a purchase decision because they would delay the purchase decision, which means Mahindra was a commuting decision. You know, I want to buy a car. Let me buy this. I can buy this. I can buy this. But now he's gone to fans. He says, I will only address my fan who just live for this. This was the desire to have it. And he's doing the right thing. So you will see when this car launches, I'm very hopeful. that it would create a history that never Thar sold so much, which they sold in pandemic. That kind of rule will come. But purely because he just picked up the fans and took it out and this and that. Like mobile phone, Apple would come. You'll see a fans would come, right? This fan always wanted the first Apple. Whenever they comes in, they come in their hand. So these companies are smart. They did never lose their fan. So you really have to see where you fit in and how you were able to do that. Yeah.
All right. The next question is from Mahima Suri. She says, as a waste management and recycling company, how can we create our own brand value?
I think Mahima, the answer is you have answer in your what you do, you know, in terms of waste management, recycling or circular economy itself is a demand side. You know, it's from a brand building side. I think one, there are very few companies, very few people are doing this. So there is a kind of a blue ocean kind of a structure. Second, I think this is a topic which everybody is talking anyway. So you need to really use them to talk about it. So everybody's already talking, you know, every industry, every company, every organization has to talk about it. A government has to talk about it. Now you need to really see how you integrate with them and they talk about you. So fundamentally, so it's much easier for you. What I was saying, talk to through your customers, not to your customers. So make sure who are your customers and talk to them. And say you are doing something with any of the recycling, like say large organization, PepsiCo, another company, they all are talking. How do you integrate and how do you really create your structure? So those are what would be my early ideas. So you need to really see through that who's your customer, and customer are these corporates and companies and which are need to look at recycling and waste management. And they, if they say, oh, we work with this company because they are the best in the town and we work with them, it builds your brand equity. So in your case, I would say brand alliances would play a very big role.
Great. So the next question we have from from Captain Amit Rai. He says, how are you seeing the utility energy sector where most of the offices are not operational and suddenly closing down?
Utility energy, most of the operational and suddenly closing out, which you're talking about because of pandemic, this issue has, Captain, if I understand, which needs to be done. Yeah, so any B2B supply business, B2B service businesses, if they are directly related to any of the corporates or structure which are not working at this stage, would obviously have an impact. But what I'm saying is this is a pause period. This obviously is a different discussion. So it's more about how do you really sustain this period and pause this period so that your consumption when it comes on, or all alternatively find a new target group which would start consuming. And I think a lot of companies are doing that. A lot of companies are quickly changing their target groups. And for example, I tell you, we have a company we are doing. It's actually a diesel supply company. So what they do is that they supply diesel to industrial businesses. And in these days, when the lockdown started, obviously all the industries were shut. Nobody was buying it. They quickly shift their focus to agriculture. So they started doing agriculture because agriculture was still on and they need gensets and diesel and other thing. And agriculture is actually a very unserviced market for diesel side. So they quickly shifted. So entire lockdown, they were doing a lot of supplies to agriculture. So you have to really think through. And I think Indians are very smart. They quickly change and pivot and find out what is the best way to do it.
Great. I would just like to take up the last question now. The question is by Ms. Meghna Soni. She says, I'm a startup, a training and development company. Can you give me tips to build a brand in the COVID scenario for my company?
So good question. So I also run multiple training and coaching companies. When I say I manage those companies, global organizations. So in that, I always say that when you're doing a training and any kind of professional service business, their brands are actually two. One is your company and second is you yourself. So put a lot of effort on yourself, most effort on you. So if you become an authority and opinion leader and things which you do, then you will not have the risk of commoditization. Otherwise, training and development as a corporate brand or something like that, sooner or later becomes commoditized. Even the biggest training company, which Bharti's floated, if you see what kind of rates and the structure they work on, this is already commoditized. So fundamental is that for training and development company, I always see that personality plays a very important role. don't go the other way around. Don't go and commoditize yourself and start addressing everybody. Put yourself out there. Put yourself in the, use LinkedIn. LinkedIn is a fabulous media for yourself. Make yourself authority, make yourself opinion leader. And as you start doing it, you're seeing your organization also start benefiting from that. So that should be my advice.
Wonderful. Thank you so much for your time, Gaurav sir, and for very patiently answering all our questions. Anything you would like to say in the end?
Thank you. We will see you all at the next edition. At next time is Sonali's value. We're doing value.
Yes.
Next time we'll talk about value and also talk about exit. Exit is a part of how do you find exit, and a lot of people are looking to exit their business. So if you are interested to listen to it, please come over. And this is something which we at Business X day and day night work on, helping people to find profitable exits. I should like to call it like profitable exit, but sometimes it's not so profitable, but we are these days working hard to give people profitable exits.
Thank you so much, Gaurav sir. Thank you to all our attendees for your time. We really hope we were able to add some value to your lives through this session. And as Gaurav sir said, we would see you next time on Saturday at 3 o'clock with another session. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. Bye.